Alrighty, hello and welcome to another episode of New Game Plus. This is our live TV record on Twitch, and thank you very much for joining us. My name is Jason, I'm your host. I'm joined by two of the older guard for New Game Plus. That is, of course, Mr. Donald and Mr. Jamie. Thank you very much for joining us.
Hello, how you doing? How you doing, you lovely internet people, you? Because it's a very interesting time in games right now, because stuff is out. Stuff is out.
And stuff is coming out as well. I think we're, like, as much as there is a lot of, you know, September was, for September standards, there was some decent stuff out, but October's another crazy month. Like, it really is not going to stop until it stops, kind of thing. So,
and then November is madness.
Yeah, pretty much. So, normally we do the news, normally Jack at this point. I'm taking over for Jack, who is taking a week or two off. I think he wanted me to best to break off, which is fair enough. Normally Jack would do news right now, but I got Donald. So why don't I just make Donald do the news? Do you want to do the news, Donald?
He got to steal all the good, big juicy news weeks. Because last week we had the big Bethesda Microsoft announcement. The week before we had all the console announcements. This week's... But there still has been some news this time. And just at the end, to kick things off, let's talk about the Xbox Series external storage solutions, because Microsoft has made available the external storage cards that will provide expandable storage for the Xbox Series consoles. There is a catch, however. They will cost, in Australia, $359 for 1 terabyte. To add some context to that, the Series X has 1 terabyte of internal storage, whilst the Series S has 512 gigabytes. And then the thing is, if you want to have some external storage, if you want to run your games rather off external storage, you will need these proprietary storage cards because of the SSD technology that is utilized by the Xbox Series consoles. Still, you can store game files on external USB hard drives. You'll just need to transfer back and forth between the SSDs if you want to actually play them.
Isn't that what the Wii Shop did? Isn't that what the Wii Shop did? It was the same thing where you could store it on the SSD, but to run.
It was the old fridge analogy, if I remember correctly. You have to kind of take stuff out of your fridge and kind of store it back out. It was really, really dumb.
Those things didn't cost 2/3 of the price of the base console now, did it?
Yep.
Therein lies the rub. Yeah, because that to me is just crazy. Like, that is some Sony Memory Stick Duo Vita memory card tier shenanigans. Like, holy crap. I mean, I guess the difference you could say is that unlike, say, you know, the Vita memory cards or the memory card duos, there wasn't really an equivalent product. Like, they like to pretend that like they were, you know, this unique platform or whatever, but they weren't really that much faster than Compact Flash or SD in its time. This, you know, is its own unique, specialized SSD technology, sure, but still $350. Like, Jesus, like, that's a lot of money.
If memory serves, and admittedly I kind of should have done a little bit of looking into this, it's roughly around the same place as like a 1 terabyte M2 SSD, if I remember correctly, Don. Would that be correct?
Yeah. The only time I've been on the PC websites is to refresh 3080 cards. They are still sold out, by the way.
Fair enough. Thank you for the update. But yeah, no, just like I get the fact that, like, from what I understand, it's roughly around the same price. If I remember correctly, it is roughly around the same price as, like, a 1 terabyte M2 SSD, which is roughly what they're going for, which... it's great. It's really fast storage. I love it. I have an M2 in my computer right now, but it's like, I don't know if I'd pay $350 for the equivalent in my console, especially when...
Clony reckons at $289 for the SSD you're discussing.
So you're definitely paying proprietary tax there. And which is, compares in contrast with the other side, with Sony, with the PlayStation 5, where you can put in your own... MM2 SSD. It has that expandable storage. Admittedly, it only works with certain SSDs that meet a specific speed threshold, ones which aren't really available on the consumer market at the moment, but we've been reassured by Sony they should be available by the end of the year. So that's a much more flexible solution than Microsoft. So the shoe is very much on the other foot, isn't it? Although, or rather, we're going back to the PS3 360 days, aren't we?
Well, I mean, if we're going back to those days, it's like, hey, I could just buy a standard hard drive and just chuck it straight on my PS3.
That was one thing when we did the News Game Plus podcast with Dermot the other day. That was one thing we said, is like, as much shit as I love to give Sony, the one thing that they did really well was the fact that for PS3 and PS4, you could just put in laptop hard drives. You know what I mean? Like, and you can put an SSD into your PS4, I think, and it slightly increases the speed. But as a general rule, at least you could just buy some proprietary. Hell, you could, in my old PS4, PS3, I used my old laptop hard drive because I had like a 250 gig laptop hard drive in there. I just took it out and chucked it into the PS3, and it was fine. You know what I mean? Like, it just worked. So credit to them, like, on that. That was probably one of the things that I think Sony's always been pretty decent on. We'll see how that goes for this gen, though.
Yeah, it's also interesting given that games are going to be big on these consoles because of the aim for 1440p and 4K textures. It means that the game files, which have already sort of blown up to around 50 to 100 gigs this generation, or an entire freaking hard drive if you want to play Warzone, then like it's only going to get even bigger. Having said that, Microsoft did confirm that the Series S files will be about, on average, 30% smaller than the Series X equivalents, just because they aim for that lower texture quality.
Yeah.
You get SSD in there. I mean, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, that's all. Yeah, that. Although, let's face it, like, this won't be an issue that we'll have to worry about until next year, given the stock issues that continue to persist with those consoles. Hey.
I mean, look, I would be really nice if I could tell sometime too. It's like, hey, you're getting your Xbox Series X sometime in November or December. That would be really cool. I mean, Jason, you're in the same boat as well, correct?
Yeah, I'm JB Hi-Fi. It's the same difference. I mean, that was the fast. And then have you seen Tajay have had to while back there? They were sending confirmation emails out to people, and now this week they're sending out emails saying to people, by the way, you actually didn't get one? Yeah, that's a bit full on, yeah.
But at least they're refunding people, which is the good
thing.
That's
true. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, the same thing is happening all around the world as well. I think Amazon America was sending out cancellation emails to certain customers saying that they might not get their things at launch.
Were they sending out emails saying you've accidentally just bought an Xbox One? Would you like to change your order?
I hope that there was at least a 72-hour regret window before they shipped out those Xbox.
Look, I mean, the nice thing with it is, like, Xbox One X sits in that one, that interesting spot where it's in some ways it's more technically more powerful than the Series S, but with obviously the backwards compatibility of it, like, there's worse mistakes to make. But obviously, if you wanted a Series X and you bought a One X, well then, you know, maybe you should read what's on the website before you click the money button. Yeah.
Yeah, Microsoft have bad names.
I'll continue to maintain that they're no worse than mobile phone naming conventions, and we've certainly gotten used to that, haven't we?
That is the path they went down, and I'm not convinced it was a good path, but that is, you know, with Series X, like, it's definitely the path they went down, and I'm like...
Xbox All Access, the 24-month subscription to Xbox All Access is very much the Australian mobile phone plan personified.
And it does remind me of, it reminds me of the Vita. Remember the Vita you could buy through Vodafone was exactly the same kind of system to purchase it. So, yeah, it was interesting times back in those days. And, again, I'm not surprised it was Telstra who got the gong. And I think some of the Telstra Wave 2 customers were upgraded to Wave 1, which obviously probably is good for them in that obviously now they'll get it potentially earlier.
The allocations that were previously assigned to the physical stores were then transferred to online because, again, physical
who can go into a store?
Physical stores, exactly, in 2020.
Yeah. Speaking of 2020, in more industry-centric news, CD Projekt Red, the developers of the upcoming Cyberpunk 2077, has told its employers that they will now have to work six-day weeks up until the game's launch in November. This comes after a previous pledge from the studio not to force its employees into crunch.
So, did anyone not see this coming? I'm sorry to be that guy, but did anyone
I think pre-COVID, everyone thought COVID would blow over in a couple of months. Everyone thought it would be done by, you know, presidents and normal people alike thought that it would be done by April. You know what I mean? So they made bad calls. So that doesn't excuse those bad calls. That's not to say that thing. But, yeah, it was very interesting to leverage that into a PR thing, especially at a time when there was a lot of swell around it. Like, there was a lot of big studios, you know, stories were coming out of the crunch they were going through, stuff like that. The only silver lining to it is that they are being paid overtime for crunch, so if, you know, the sixth day will become a thing. But I don't know, it'd be interesting. I feel like having mandatory crunch is still, like, as soon as you just add mandatory to it, it becomes a different conversation. Like, you know, you could talk about the intentions of the artist versus, you know, the outcome and all that kind of stuff. And I think there's genuinely valid conversation there. But if they just said anyone who works from now till thing is double overtime or overtime and a half through till whenever, And I think they still would have had a big enough uptake to, you know, solve the last few problems and stuff that they had. And then it's not mandatory. Then it's voluntary and people can take it up or whatever. But again, then you have the conversation about, you know, that kind of that soft power that the employers have where they could be like, well, you didn't show up to crunch. The next time we're looking at promotions, you know, you're not getting a gong. But I don't know what you do about those power dynamics. Either way, yeah, it is them going back on their word per se, but I don't know what the other alternative is, to be honest.
I'm just kind of shocked they just went out, they were actually blunt about it and just admitted it. Like, they just kind of said, look, we have to do this. It's like, I'm just kind of, because even with kind of, and justifiably so, all the dirty talk around Crunch, it's like, I'm actually really, really kind of shocked. It's like, you not only went back on your word, but also you just said, no, we
just owned it. Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Good on them for owning it. Like, God bless. It's like the one good bit of PR that game needs. Yeah. Lately, but it's like, yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, and like, and it is very much a direct owning of the thing. There's an email that went out to employees from the CD Projekt Red head Adam Badowski that said, quote, "I know this is in direct opposition to what we've said about Crunch. It's also in direct opposition to what I personally grew to believe a while back, that Crunch should never be the answer. But we've extended all the other possible means of navigating the solution." So it does seem like it was either this or delay the game, which then, again, this whole does raise quite a few questions about crunch culture within both, not just CD Projekt Red, but within the gaming industry as a whole. Like, as Jason said, like, it's not even just the sort of the soft pressures of what's called, whether you'll be considered for promotions come the next project, but it's also just that it's just the culture that's endemic in a lot of major game studios of not necessarily show you the only way to show your commitment to the game is to spend every waking hour on it away from family or free time.
No project is ever worth that. It's never ever worth kind of sacrificing your
again.
Within the studios, within the rigors and pressures of a particular office, then it does become an entirely different question.
Plus, I mean, like I say, like, especially for indie devs, it's a bit of a different conversation, because usually with indie devs, they're directly not only like kind of creatively involved, but also there's an equity, you know, that they have, whether it's a personal equity or a literal like financial equity in what is happening. So therefore, it's more like worthwhile for them to just basically, to push harder because they want to see this thing come to fruition because it's something they're a part of. And that can still definitely infect the wider mindset. Like, just because it happens in a indie studio, I'm sure it does happen to some people in like a 200-person studio where they're like, I'll sacrifice these things because I want to see this thing made. I want to see the culmination of 4 years of my life come out. But again, it comes down to the flip side of it, of course, is consumer pressures. Like, they delay it. I mean, what does that mean for their share price? What does that mean for all the whingy, complaining gamers on the internet and stuff like that? And people have been a little bit more understanding about the delays, but look at what Halo copped for delaying. Like, the feedback wasn't great about Halo. They delayed it. Now they're copping more crap for it. Not that they care, because I don't think it affects their launch plans particularly, but it's definitely, you know, there's so many factors involved that it's easy to say, well, studios shouldn't do it. It's like, sure, in a vacuum, I think you're absolutely right, and I think, you know, at least they've owned their own hypocrisy on this. But I mean, what's the answer? Like, a better consumer culture, a better dev culture. Like, there's so many facets.
Even around the stories of crunch culture around Crystal Dynamics with the Avengers or Naughty Dog with The Last of Us Part 2. Like, we still bought those games, and we still heavily invested and adored those games in case of Last of Us Part 2, or not in the case of Avengers. But the fact is, like, the consumers aren't necessarily going to punish Crunch even if they know about it. Like, even me personally, like, I've not crossed that line yet of not playing a game due to the adverse industry conditions, because the logical conclusion of that is to never consume anything ever.
Exactly.
Yeah. There's no ethical consumption under capitalism. I mean, that's the meme, but there's some truth to it.
I mean, I'll admit, like, I bought a copy. I mean, I'm kind of the same. Like, I bought a copy of Last of Us 2. I bought a copy of Red Dead as well. It's like, I know these are games that are made under, let's say, less than ideal conditions. That's probably the polite way I can say it. And I feel I knew that going in, but it's like, I'm part of the problem, and I. Yeah. But again, no. What's the old again? No ethical. It's. But at the same time, it's like if you again, it's just that whole idea is like if you kind of look at everything, you're like, okay, what do you buy? What do you support? It just feels like everything is being made under these conditions. It's just like, I know it sounds really shitty, but it's like, how can you support it? Like, it's just
So I'm just going to quickly address something that came up in our chat. Seffi did mention, you know, imagine working in the construction industry. But I would say that there's one thing that you can remember about the construction industry is they have strong unions. Do you know what I mean? Like, yeah, you might be stuck on that job site, but it's something that you agreed to as part of collective bargaining with your union, which got you extra money, which got you extra benefits. And that's why you should unionize. Just a thought process for the devs out there. Even if your local Australian reps for the particular union aren't great human beings, you should still unionise because I think the wider movement kind of dictates that you should. And that's the end of my bullshit speech. That's a lie. I'll probably come in later with something. But that's it for now. We can move on to the next news item, I think.
Well, at least thinking that has been the Jason Bolshevik minute.
Yeah.
Like, on a less dire note, Among Us, we all know Among Us, right? We've played it many times here in New Game Plus.
What's
you viewers have probably played it yourselves. It's experienced a massive surge in popularity. A sequel was in the works, considering Among Us was originally released in 2018. However, the developer Inner Sloth has confirmed in a blog post that it is cancelling Among Us 2 to instead put all of its resources into improving Among Us 1.
So this is like the Xavian thing for the people, the developers who made The Culling, except it sounds like this is actually going in a positive direction, unlike the absolute clusterfuck that is that was that video game. And if you don't believe me, this is the one that went back and said, oh, we're going to make it free to play, but also you have to pay to kind of get some for additional games. It's like, great job, guys.
I remember when The Culling first came out. It was before PUBG. It was kind of in that weird period where it was Tarkov. It was before PUBG. There was another one as well. It was in that same kind of genre, and he was doing really well on Twitch. Like it was great. Like I had Dota streamers playing it all the time and stuff like that. And it's amazing to see how well Tarkov has done. Like Tarkov has managed to just stay pretty stable. You know, they have spikes when they've got new content and stuff. And the nature of the way Tarkov works just really fits that kind of thing well. And then you've got what they did to The Culling. And yeah, so it sounds to me like it was a good move in that they recognize that there's more room to play if they fix the existing one as opposed to starting a new one.
It does sound like it'll be a massive undertaking, though. Like, it basically involves, like, an entire rewriting of the code in order to make it as expandable to be able to fix certain issues that have been plaguing it. Like,
well, there's still definitely bugs, server issues
and things like that. And to add colorblind support, to add friends and account systems, things like that.
How would you do colorblind? I guess you just do patterns on the characters or something for colorblind support.
I suppose it would also go into like the color, the art of the levels themselves, or the various jobs as well.
I mean, look,
just get better chromosomes, guys. Come on, like
I know. I think it's a cool move, and also, hey, that developer, that team's only three people. That team's only made up of three people. Like, think about that. Like, it's nuts.
They would have been like, oh, that little game we made did all right. I paid my mortgage off with that, and now it's just like Scrooge McDucky and Vault kind of shit.
And it's strange how like the games of the second half of the year have been these smaller, these very much small team projects, like with Fall Guys, Among Us, a third thing, third example, which I'm sure I'm forgetting.
Come, like we've still got what 2 months left in the year. There's probably gonna be something coming.
Yeah, it'll probably be like at this point. Like, I think the big game might end up being actually Cyberpunk, just because like during a loud period of time being console launches.
I would say the first game that really of these kind of, I don't want to say like casual games, but they're very easy to pick up. Fall Guys, super easy. It's three buttons. You know what I mean? Like three buttons and your D-pad. That's the kind of thing that normies can process. I would say the first one was Animal Crossing. Like Animal Crossing came out at the perfect time to capitalize on that semi-normie crowd, and now you're seeing all the switches on the websites going for super cheap because they want to get rid of them. So I mean, if you ever want to buy a copy of Animal Crossing in a Switch Lite, now's the time to check out your Facebook pages.
I mean, there was a really great Twitter, again, oxymoron, but hear me out. There's a really great Twitter post someone made, I think it was like a few weeks ago. It's like, oh yeah, the top game of the pandemic was Animal Crossing. Everyone that started a pandemic, like, oh yeah, we're going to get through this, we're all optimistic, we're going to build our build our houses and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
6 months later, the top game of the pandemic is Among Us, a game where we literally have to be secretive and kill each other.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I think it just it was. Like, you know, if you want to go to the Twitch history, you know, Bulldog was one of the first to play it, and then one of the Twitch admins played it with Soda Pop, and then once you hit Soda Pop in numbers, it just, it hits a certain point of proliferation. So, so I don't know. It'll be very interesting to see what happens with it going forward. I think they made the right move by making instead of releasing a new one, they released remade the old one, I should say, but I don't know. I think it was a good call.
There'll be plenty of opportunities to watch us play Among Us in future streams. Shameless plug. And finally, because we're New Game Plus, we have to talk about a Tokyo Game Show. Because
do we know? Do we know?
We have to at least acknowledge its presence, because normally we would be boots on the ground covering the show, but not so much this year because, you know, the pandemic. But however, there was still some news to come out of it, at least some gameplay footage for the upcoming Hyrule Warriors Age of Calamity, Monster Hunter Rise, Resident Evil Village, Nier Replicant, version 1.2, blah, 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 blah,
blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah,
blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah,
blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, blah, It'll be coming out. That'll be coming out in April 2021, by the way. Although there was also the Game Show Awards, the Japan Game Awards rather, which announced its 2020 winners. Jason, Jamie, let's have an impromptu game of quiz time event here. What game took out the grand award?
That was Animal Crossing. Yeah.
0 points for getting Animal Crossing correct. Which game won the game designers award?
That was Baba, wasn't it?
Yes, 1 point towards Jason. Hey, Jason, you finally won a quiz time event.
Yeah, congratulations to me. At least you can actually hear me this time. You weren't lying about your buzzers. Screw you.
I'm sorry. I need another requisite 30 seconds of collusion accusations.
This is the show record. We don't have time for that.
Yeah, although there are also awards for excellence awarded to various titles like 13 Sentinels, Aegis Rim, which we will be reviewing later in this episode, as well as Death Stranding, Fire Emblem, Monster Hunter World, Iceborne, which we regularly stream on twitch.tv/newgameplustv, Neo, Persona 5 Royal, Pokemon Sword and Shield, Ring Fit Adventure, and Yakuza Like a Dragon.
I would also like to talk about very quickly that Sega very nearly kind of sort of announced a new Virtua Fighter thing, and it was the first
time. Yeah.
Oh, okay, they announced a Virtua Fighter X Esports thing, which everyone, it's just like, we put some fancy footage together with the words Virtua Fighter Cross Esports. It's like, what does that mean? We don't know, because Sega didn't want to say anything. But I'm like, it's them acknowledging Virtua Fighter in a significant way, which they haven't done in 10 freaking years. I am just, if it's whatever it is, I will be excited, and I'll be very happy to see what it is. I am not going to say it's VF6, because I'm not a crazy person.
You've been heard before, yeah.
I've heard it before, but it's like, I just want to see, what is this? What is a VF? What is VF in 2021?
It's a gacha game.
Sure, fuck it, I don't care.
Look, don't give my ideas, like, yeah.
No, you just know that is already written on a whiteboard somewhere at Sega.
Just circled.
Make it free to play. Make it full on gacha free to play Virtua Fighter. I would be okay with that.
Jamie, only Jamie would be okay with that. No, thank you. Like, yeah.
I would be okay with new Virtua Fighter. Thank you very much. I don't care what it is at this point. Just, I would like something new that's not just, we put Virtua Fighter in Yakuza, guys. Like, great.
You know, Virtua Fighter 5 on Steam is going to be what they're going to announce. You know that as well as anyone. It'll be the PC version.
Sure. Why not? I don't care.
Like, as long as they implement some good netcode, then I'm sure that'll be a boon for the
Japanese fighting games have good netcode. Come on, Donald.
Yeah, yeah. Nowadays it's less crazy talk, but it's still a little bit crazy talk. So.
Yep, and yeah, that's that is very much every news story that has happened in the world ever this past week. Nothing else has actually happened. If you say anything else happened, I will firmly deny.
That's fake news. That's fake news. All right. On that note. Say again.
Nothing. It was a dumb joke. Don't worry.
All right, cool. On that note, we're going to go to a quick break now, reset for our next segment, which is going to be an interview with Tina from Cotton Candy Cyanide for her game Quantum Suicide. But we'll be back after the break with that. Stay tuned for more New Game Plus fun.
My name is Tina. I am from Cotton Candy Cyanide. It is a indie studio from the Gold Coast that is currently in Japan. And we make Quantum Suicide, a visual novel game. So it's a visual novel game, and visual novels are almost like your choose your own adventure books, but in a video game format. So you make choices, and then some of those choices will lead you down different pathways. Quantum Suicide itself is about a spaceship in which you are brought upon with no memory, and then you're thrown into this situation where the AI system has decided that there's too many people on board now that you've arrived, and so starts a game in which the loser each week is then executed. And you have to navigate your way through that. There are very few games in kind of like the death game genre. So games in which, you know, you repeat it against each other and it's pretty much, you know, try to survive. So I had played other games of that nature. And then when I realized that I couldn't find any more, I was pretty upset about it. And I sooked for a little while and then realized, why am I sooking if I could just make one myself? So I decided to do that and just add to the genre. So I first found a engine that I could that was kind of geared towards visual novels, and then I played around with it for a day and tried to work out whether or not it was even possible before I started getting my hopes up. And then I could get something functioning, working. It was not pretty, but it worked. And so I was like, all right. And then from there, started working on a story to get fed into it. We are only a studio of one. It pretty much just comes with me wherever I go. It was like there were other challenges, though, through development that were much more unproductive and more disruptive than a move. Because I came here to study. So the whole time I've been making Quantum Suicide, I've been doing a doctorate. So I started a doctorate in Gold Coast, and then have come and done a master's in Japan. Yeah, so at no time have I ever been full-time developer. I've always been doing it on the side of full-time study and part-time jobs. I've never really spoken to any of the contributors ever. It's all through written. So I don't know what most of them look like. I don't know where some of them are. No, it's all been mainly written communication. So for example, with the artist, for example, a CG artist, I would draw him a picture myself really, really badly because I can't draw, and then send it to him, and then he would try and do like a draft and then send it back to see if that's what I meant. And usually he was pretty good, spot on. So it was just a lot of back and forth of doing that. So I have an entire folder of just my drawings. Well, there's even some pictures in the game that I drew, but they're supposed to be that of a four-year-old, and it's pretty accurate.
The few times that I've seen Quantum Suicide, I guess, as in the flesh, if you will, have been at Tokyo Game Show. So, you're based in Japan, and going to Tokyo Game Show, is that really the most sort of, expo floor or, public showing of a game that you've had up until release?
Yes, I've done TGS and I've done PAX, and I did GX as well when it had that one time in Sydney. But yeah, Tokyo Game Show is definitely the biggest, but PAX, because it's native language of English, is much easier for me. So it's much more chill, whereas obviously the Japanese market is very different. And then I also have to try and use a second language. And so it's nowhere near as fun.
I guess when you're, because you mentioned your doctorate was in otome games, the visual novel genre, I guess, seems much more successful in a place like Japan. You look at, you go into a book off or something and you're like, how many visual novels, how many, BL games that never obviously made the jump to the West are on PSP that never got translated? Much as it would be more difficult to pretend, even just communicate to the Japanese market, does the feedback that you get from them, how does that differ from a Western market at a PAX or a GX?
Most of it is pretty similar. The only thing I really noticed that was a big difference was promotional art. One works really well for a Western audience and one works really well for a Japanese audience. So I wasn't aware of that until obviously trial and error. So now I have two main box arts for the game. One made specifically for Japan, and one that was the original one that worked for the West. But other than that, everything else is relatively the same. Japanese audiences are, like, they have particular ideas of what characters should sound like when they kind of hit an archetype, which at first I didn't have correct, but hopefully I've rectified that now, so I changed voice actor for some of the characters. But for English, they were just like, woo.
Did you go through a publisher, or did you self-publish?
No, self-publish.
Tell me about that experience. What was it like trying to go through Steam, go through storefronts, setting all of that up, all of the admin? I mean, put aside all the programming problems, more on just like the management side, the admin side. What was that like?
A lot of work. So if people have a publisher or have a admin person who does it all, I'm very jealous. I would have liked to have saved time. But no, it's all relatively, like, easy. It just takes time. So, like, each storefront needs different asset sizes and, you know, different things like that. So you just got to be prepared to kind of modify for each one. And the actual process, so getting onto Steam was relatively easy. But that's because the game has been in development for so long that we got greenlit back when that was a thing. which, yeah, so that was a while ago.
You sound really chill about it, man.
The length of time or the green lighting? Because the green lighting was pretty scary, given how people had games on there for like 6 months and they got nowhere. And I was like, I don't know, even know if we're going to get onto Steam at this point. But we were lucky enough to get greenlit in a week. So,
I mean, it's been in development for 6 years. How has some of the different aspects of the game changed in that time? Like, you know, coming up to release, let's say in the last year or so, would you look back at some of the assets or some of the writing or something like that that you might have done earlier in the process and been like, this needs to be reworked?
I'm sure I probably should have reflected and changed things. But no, I think if anything, like, it pretty much got to a point where, I'll just say it very bluntly, we were running out of resources, that's the word I'm after. Yeah. So things like after the, like, kind of IP struggle, like, there was no money left, there was none of this sort of thing. And so obviously things that were originally planned started kind of whittling a bit more, because, yeah. So if we could go back and do that again, I would have liked to have obviously had the resources to do more in particular areas. So there's bits and pieces that, if given the opportunity, I would definitely like to, like, kind of, like, tie up loose ends a bit better. But at the current point, like, like, to give you an idea that so with the Kickstarter funding that we had, it didn't last as long as I would have liked, which I'm sure is every Kickstarter game ever. And so has been self-funded through my, like, student scholarship and part-time jobs I could do on the side for the bulk of the last. So, yeah, so it just got to a point where I'm like, eat? Put in a new scene. I'm like, I guess I can't do any more scenes if I'm dead.
Has it been sort of what you expected? Like, have you gotten a whole lot of feedback in the first week of release? Have the bug fixes been not too soul-destroying? Or, I mean, is the feedback not being sold? Give me the vibe.
Look, it's been an experience, that's for sure. Unfortunately, because there was no money, there was never any paid QA testing. So as soon as that release button happened, every problem that could have arose.
They could have happened.
Every problem possible happened.
So it's been like going back through and seeing through feedback and bug reports and all the rest of it, just how to try and address that.
Yep. So I, as soon as I launched onto Steam, I made sure to make a discussion thread that is just for bug reporting and posting. So, like, most people have been super, super helpful and, like, pointing out things and then letting me know when it does work, because obviously I'm pushing patches to try and fix things. Even though, like, currently we're still sitting at a mixed and we have some pretty bad reviews, the people who really like it seem to really like it, and those people are being pretty patient with me and trying to help me fix all the problems that it's on. Like, regardless of what it looks like, I'm actually pretty happy. Like, it could have been smoother, but I'm pretty happy with the community and the response. So,
And we are back. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you for watching that as well. Troy, for the follow on the Twitch channel. Don't forget to do follow us and go to newgameplus.tv if you do want some more of our content. We stream most nights. We're on the television, and we do a bunch of other stuff as well. Thank you as well to Tina for joining us live from Japan. Shout-outs to the Kansai crew. Gentlemen, a game that has been out, I guess, now for... How long has it technically been out for? What, 8 months? Well, no, I mean it's been pre-released for a long time.
It's been in early access since December 2018, finally came out in version 1.0.
The truly Epic Game Store, because it's only Epic stuff allowed. Hades is the game that we are discussing, which is of course the latest game from Supergiant. I'm pretty sure that's who they're called. That's their name, isn't it?
Supergiant Games. This is their fourth game after Transistor, Pyre, and Bastion. And
I forgot about Pyre. Yeah.
Yeah, everyone did. It's okay.
A lot of people did, unfortunately. Anyway, you can watch a review for Pyro on newgameplus.tv. But we're talking about Hades today, which is a roguelite dungeon crawler, which we have to admit is a very, 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 very crowded genre. Even in the current month, we've got no less than 3 or 4 roguelite dungeon crawlers coming out. However, there is something that sets Hades apart from all of these games, and that is just the absolute polish that it received, not just from the two and so years of early access, but from the past 10 years of Supergiant Games. I'm stealing from the Steam store page copy here, but it's very much got the action combat of Bastion. It's got the art style and aesthetic of Transistor. It's got the branching narrative of Pyre. It's a combination of all that into this game, which arguably is the best game that Supergiant Games has released, and that is a very high standard. It should be known.
I will. So
for those who haven't played them, all the games you're describing are isometric, kind of looking down action games. As a general, again, I've never touched, but Transistor and Bastion were both that kind of borderline grid base for Bastion, but it kind of freed itself up a little bit for Transistor.
And it's got an emphasis on art style and on narrative as well.
Yes, 100%. Yeah. So one of the Bastion memes was always the very well done narration over the top of it and stuff like that. So they really, when they go down an aesthetic path, they take it to its natural conclusion. And it seems like that's what they've done with Hades. Obviously, it's the Greek pantheon and all that kind of stuff. Like, I mean, but I guess the thing is, like, if you've played Bastion, have you played Hades? Do you know, like, enough different? Yeah.
Yes.
I'd argue that, yes, Jamie, have you played Bastion recently?
I kind of touched a little bit of the phone version when they made it free not too long ago, but no, not super recently.
But even from, like, your memories and looking back on gameplay, there is a certain, like, there's a certain flow and pizzazz, for the want of a better word, that wasn't really present in Bastion's combat, which is very much present in Hades, because like it being a roguelite, the whole aim is that you crawl through dungeons until you die, and then you do it all over again until you eventually don't die. But the moment to moment combat in this game just feels incredibly tight and snappy. Something as small as the dash button, like the way the dashing feels in this game, of bouncing around the room as you evade your enemies, even that small act feels satisfying. Add on to that the 6 weapons on offer, each with their own various modifications, and going through dungeons it just has a compelling, like, I'm just going through all the gamer stereotype superlatives here, so visceral, endlessly satisfying, things like that. It's just an incredibly fun game to play in the moments to moments.
Absolutely.
And then, Jason, you alluded to the Greek mythology, and that is very much running through the entire game. As in, for one, you play as Zagreus, son of Hades, as you try to escape from the underworld to the surface for reasons that you'll discover as you go through the game. But along the way, and this is kind of what makes every run different, is the fact that you receive boons from the various Olympian gods to power up your run. So, for instance, you might be met by Zeus, who will give you the ability to add chain lightning to your attacks. You may be then met by Ares, the god of war, to be able to add doom effects to Dionysus, who will give your enemies hangover, which is basically poison.
I would like to call you out. I am pretty sure that Kratos is the god of war. But
Sony, don't believe Sony's lies, please.
And that's Galea saying that.
I walked straight into that one. But nonetheless, like, you'll eventually, like, as you play on, you'll eventually discover, like, the favorite gods that you like, you'll discover a really synergistic build that just absolutely cuts hard through enemy and makes your race to the final boss just incredibly easy.
Yeah, I guess I could pop in here because I've been playing a bunch of Hades, not as much as Don, but I've been playing a bunch of it too, and I think I agree with most of what he's saying. Like, to me, it just feels really tight. It feels really just fun just to get into a fight and just kind of discover what works and what doesn't work on the fly. I think it really works. But I think the thing that really strikes out to me, and I play a lot of roguelikes, a lot of bad ones, a lot of good ones, but I think the thing that really stands out to me is that it's really reactive in a way I haven't seen any other roguelike really do. Like, there's moments where the game will comment on just really, really, really specific things. Like, for instance, hey, you've got the timer on because you want to time your runs. Oh, you just run into a goddess, it will comment on the fact that, hey, I see you're timing yourself. Well done. You've got you've got your character commenting when you're in the, I think it's when you're in the, not the pause menu, the stats menu, you're looking at your build. And if you're being attacked there, he'll comment on that. Your character will comment on previous runs. Other characters will comment on the stuff you've done in the game world. Like, it's just, it's really, really cool. And there's always, it feels like, compared to most of the roguelikes I've played, there's always something new. And that's really cool.
Yeah, and that's the thing with the other thing that pushes Hades, sets Hades apart from the rest of the roguelite and roguelike crowd is the emphasis on narrative as well. They managed to fit a narrative into a game that is essentially about running the same course over and over again. Because as Jamie said before, like each time you run into a character, they will have a bit of dialogue that is either reacting to your previous actions, either on your last life or your current build at the moment, or they'll have a bit of dialogue that alludes to either the greater narrative of why Zagreus is trying to escape from Hades, or even just a small character moment like Hades, like the fact that Hades really dislikes the god of the sea. I'm blanking on his name.
Poseidon.
Neptune.
Poseidon. Yeah, he really has a beef with Poseidon for some reason. And you get that with all the characters, not just the Olympian gods, but also the various characters of the underworld too, from Megara, who you run into like at the end of the first biome, to even just the Adusa, the person that cleans up around the house of Hades, where you return to at the start of, at the end of every life after you die. The only kind of shame with that is that the narrative itself is great. It compels you to keep on going even if you run into a wall in the actual game as you die over and over again. You still get some sort of narrative reward. The only catch is a lot of narrative is back-ended, so that you need to actually clear a run before you get a semblance of the greater narrative, and then you have to beat the game 9 more times in order to get the true ending and credits, which does kind of prevent a lot of people from seeing this game potentially through to its end.
That's a little bit Gungeon. So Gungeon's got a very similar thing, if I can jump in there, Jamie. So, you know, you had you had to take all the different elements of the gun that can kill time, and then you have to do a run with every single player with all those elements, get to the final part, pick up the bullet, pick up the gun, and then beat your true pass. So you had to beat it at least 8 times to get, no more, like 10, 12 times to get to the thing. And then, like I said, then all of it kind of starts to make sense in the wider thing. So it seems to be that these well-made kind of narrative-driven roguelikes tend to have those same limitations because it relies on you having passed it at least once or twice to understand the overarching narrative.
And Jamie, you were saying something there as well?
Yeah, I was about to pop in and say, because one of the things that this game does that I don't think I've ever seen any other roguelike do is they offer an assistance mode called God Mode, which basically saying you can toggle on at any point in the game, which basically decides, because they wanted to give make it a way for people who maybe don't want to play a lot of roguelikes, maybe are struggling through the game, or maybe just want to have a good time with it. You can just turn it on and it gives you a permanent 20%. As long as you have it on, obviously, you have a 20% A 20% damage resistance, which is a big deal. Thank you. which is actually really something, because it's not, you may think, oh, it's not an easy mode. It's not an easy mode, because that would imply that you can just finish the game really easy. Like, I did a run with God mode on, just to kind of see, okay, what's it like, because I wanted to know. I got to the end of the game, and I died, but furthest I'd been, but I just find that's a really interesting thing, like, they actually added in the means of, if you're struggling, you could just turn this on at any point. There's no punishment for doing it. You don't get locked out of anything. Here it is. And if you keep dying, they also increase the resistance. So I think at the moment, I died once. I think it's out 22% damage resistance, if I remember correctly.
I believe it's, yeah, it's, you get a 2% increase every time you die. So, like, it's a good way to be able to see the narrative through. And like, it's a good way to both have the narrative seeds fit in through the repeated deaths, but still give a lot of players the opportunity to experience the full range of the game. And I'm not just talking about the story or the story or the gameplay and the boons, but also just like the super giant touches. So the art style contained with all four biomes, like, it's a very, like, it's a great interpretation of the ancient Greek underworld, and the soundtrack as well. Supergiant always does great soundtracks for its games, and I would almost rate Pyre, like, as one of the more underappreciated soundtracks of the lot. But Hades, it might just be recency bias, but I would say Hades is the best work that they've done. It goes for a much more, it has a lot of traditional Greek instruments. So your bouzouki, is that how it's pronounced, Jason?
Why would you ask me? Yeah, O'Callaghanopoulos, is that my surname, is it?
Let's go with that.
It's got like a lot of Greek instruments in there, but it's also given a sort of heavy prog.
It's bouzouki, I believe.
As well. Yes.
I tell you what, the CIA is listening to my thing, because I made the joke about, what am I, Jason, like, O'Callaghanopoulos, and then the first answer on YouTube, where, like, when I did the search for it, was Irish bouzouki lessons. So I'm like, the CIA is definitely listening to my podcast. Thank you for joining us, fellas, in the alphabet agencies.
We'll have some new views with the CIA. And also with YouTube algorithms now, they feed you non-stop recommendations for Greek instruments, Jason.
Thank you for that. That's great. Yeah.
Yes, but all that is to say that the presentation in Hades is some of the best and memorable in gaming so far this year. And overall, Hades is just sticking in my mind, even though I've played quite a lot of it. I've seen the game through inside and out, but I still have a compulsion to keep on playing. Like, just from something as small as the moment-to-moment combat and going through a run with some god-awfully synergistic boon build, or just seeing the tiny snippets of narrative that I've still yet to unlock from the various hidden weapon aspects and things like that. It's a game that I just keep on, am compelled to keep on playing, but I'm grateful for it, because like, Hades is in itself a very good game to play. It's got that super giant polish. It's got the 10 years worth of roguelike lessons. It's got 10 years worth of super giant lessons. It's a combination of all of that, and I would almost say it's some of the best in gaming this year.
Okay, so that is my last question. We're going to wrap it up there. So Don, you obviously reckon it's worth checking out. It definitely sounds like you're recommending it from the point of view.
My praise for this game is somewhat overwhelming and effusive.
And Jamie, how about yourself?
I would like to say it's one of the 10 best video games of 2020.
Fair enough. I'm not convinced that's a particularly controversial statement at the moment, but that's okay. We will go to a break. We will come back and we will discuss another video game, which is 13 Sentinels. So stay tuned. Alrighty, welcome back. Thank you for joining us on this live record for New Game Plus TV. Don't forget, of course, to check out newgameplus.tv, as well as Channel 31 in Melbourne, Channel 44 in Adelaide, for your episodes of New Game Plus. And thank you again for Twitch for having us. So, I know you may not have played much of it, Don, but Jamie, I know you have. 13 Sentinels. It's a game about... It's a Japanese game about kids piloting robots.
What a
concept. I could use a little fuel myself. But realistically, it does it a little bit differently. While it still manages to kind of sit with a lot of the tropes, it takes a little bit of a different path. There's time travel involved. You flip between a bunch of different time frames. You know, obviously, the way the game is segregated is really interesting, because for a lot of these kind of games, you know, especially ones like this, which are half visual novel, half kind of... I say half. One-third visual novel, one-third Gaktan... Like, no, what's his name? Naruhodo, Ace Attorney, kind of figuring out the different things, and then part, like, tactical RPG. Do you know what I mean? It's such a weird game in the way that they present it, because these elements aren't combined. They feed into each other, and they're interlocked, but they're not all in the one thing. You play the visual novel, and you play the tactical missions, and you try and work out the index to try and figure stuff out. Did you find that jarring? Like, it's definitely different, but I'm not convinced that it's inherently bad.
I like it. I like the fact that there is such a clear divide of... There is the... I like to think of it as tower defense, more so.
Yeah,
of kind of,
yeah, tower defense is fair. Yeah, yep.
The way it also works is that... So if you basically got the two games. You've got the visual novel aspect, you've got the tower defense. But in my mind, like, okay, I come for the story. The tower defense stuff is fine. I don't hate it. I don't think it's bad, but it's also, to me, the weakest part of the game. But you can't just say, well, I'm just going to go through all this so I can go through the rest of the visual novel stuff. No, it works in concert. So you have to play... You have to play the tower defense to play the visual novel. I hit my microphone. You also have to play the visual novel to play more of the tower defense. Yeah. It works in concept. But before we go any further, there's a quote I want to read from this. So a lot of how this game came about was because there's a quote going around from Masahiro Sakurai, the creator of Smash Brothers.
Yes.
It's probably the best way I can describe this game. It's really, really amazing. So give me 1 second. I'm just going to pull this up. It's a bit of a long one, so bear with me. The presentation of a characteristic adventure scenario. Oh, hang on. That's 1 second. Deleted a few things now.
Find the right quote. Yeah.
Hang on. I got to pull this up. 1 second.
What is pre-production?
It does sound I had basically zero awareness of what 13 Sentinels is, apart from the side. It reminds me of the Wu-Tang album, Enter the whatever it is, Chambers.
36.
Enter the 36 Chambers. So, yeah. So I wasn't that far off. I was going to say 48.
Okay. I have the quote. Here we go.
But before you do that, Jamie, I do want to say it does remind me of Persona 5 in that the visual novel and the dungeon crawling aspects both feed into each other mechanically and narratively. So you've got my attention now. Jamie, win this attention with this quote of yours.
Okay. The presentation of characteristic adventure scenario. The stories in movies and novels are basically lines. Sound novel is a type of adventure game at a vertical axis, making it a 2D plane. The scenario in 13 Sentinels Aegis Rim is three-dimensional, as if it were 3D. There are 13 protagonists, and they are from different eras. At first, it was confusing and difficult to grasp, but as you continue to play, you'll become more immersed and enjoy it more as your understanding increases. You'll also become surprised at its depth. The potential in this method of presentation is endless. However, it's genuinely not possible to imitate it. It's wholly unique. There's never been a work like this before, and I don't think there'll be a continuation either. If you want to play it, it has to be now. Anyone who wants to write a game scenario should play 13 Sentinels Aegis Rim, Masahiro Sakurai. And that's is the best summary of that game.
So thank you, Sakurai, for your review.
Thank you, Samurai. Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Samurai. We've just stolen your review, just like everyone steals the New Game Plus name. I agree with that nearly in its entirety. The only thing I would say is that, because he's right in that most of the time when you're playing these kind of games, like even if you have the different trees that you can follow, like over your different playthroughs and stuff like that, I'll do that one on my second playthrough. I'll do that one on my third playthrough. This goes a step beyond that. This will literally let you just do them in the one sitting. So basically you play every character's story until a certain point that you haven't reached in the battle side of it. And the battles all take place within this kind of 1 or 2 day stretch. You know what I mean? Like every battle that you do is 3 to 4 minutes after each other. So you're in sector one of the city, and then you're in sector two of the city, you're in sector three of the city. And so it's basically the battles themselves take place over the course of like 1 day, 1 or 2 days for each kind of chapter. And that helps with the narrative because it goes, cool, here's all these things that happened in this 1 day that exist in the world of the battle system. And then you see what the ramifications of that are in the visual novel system. And the characterization's great, and there's tropes. Don't get me wrong, they know they're playing these tropes, but they're playing them with the existing things in mind, like the 80s you know, the 80s kind of tomboy, tough girl, and Ogata, the straight-up delinquent and all this kind of stuff. But like Jamie mentioned, I believe it was actually in the quote, there's different protagonists from different timelines. So there's some from 2025, so they're more modern sensibilities. You know, there's ones from, you know, even further future than that. There's ones from the past. It really does a good job of combining, I guess, the prevailing attitudes of each of those time frames and making the characters seem real, and then presenting them, you know, as part of this kind of, you know, this story, this overarching story about these, you know, what is effectively a drama. Like, there's amnesia involved, there's robots, you know, there's World War II involved. You know what I mean? Like, it really is such a wide-ranging game that following each person's narrative arc becomes interesting. And I don't even particularly like visual novels. I've never been a visual novel fan. But, yeah, well, before I do go on, thank you, Furball, for the follow as well. But, Jamie, I'll let you take over now.
Yeah, no, I absolutely agree with that. To me, like, I think it's kind of the surprising thing is that every character in every scenario is so radically different. Like, I don't want to... So this is one of those games where I'd say, look, if you really are interested in the story, you have any interest in this game at all, I would say, look, go buy it. Go buy it straight away. Because I think the less you know going in, the better.
Yeah.
But I think a lot of the scenarios do a good job of feeling different from one another. Like, I was playing one at the moment where... And because, again, it deals with a lot of time travel, I played one where one of the characters stuck in a time loop. And that they have just really interesting things with that. You've got other ones where you've got characters who are just kind of traveling between eras and how they would respond to those eras. Like, it is non-linear in a way that makes sense, but also there is totally a way, if you really want to, they list every kind of cutscene and event in a linear order if you ever want to go back to it, which if you want to make sense of the game that way, you could totally do that too. It's completely up to
you. So when I streamed it, I did that. So this, you'll understand what I say when I say this, Jamie. I was doing the Juro Kurabe story after the tutorial, right? I did most of his stuff. And then what I did on stream was I went back and I watched him meeting... what's her name? Fujishishi or whatever her name is. The glasses, glasses girl. Oh. Like, so like her meeting him, because that is such a big part of his story. Like, you know, he's the one with amnesia. This is in the tutorial, so I don't feel bad telling you. He's the one with amnesia. They meet, blah, blah. So being able to go back and go, oh, that's right, because that happened. So having all those resources on hand to go, oh, right, because that's, you know. So it really is one of those things where as more things are shown, as you take the different kind of sliding doors pathways from each thing, you see more and more how these characters interact. Like, it's like, well, hang on, well, that guy hasn't been introduced yet in this era. Or hang on, like, why is that person here? Hey, they just walked in the door and mentioned, you know, oh, wow, I can't believe this place is still here after all this time. And it's like, oh, because that's right, you're from, you know, X time. So it's interesting to see how they've managed to tie all that together and still not make it feel particularly, like, it doesn't feel like a drag to have to go through all this stuff and watch it and go back to it. But like you've reiterated twice now, I think that were you to play it, you kind of have to play it now, or you have to really go anyway to stay spoiler-free. Like, one of the things I did mention in the review guide that we got was obviously to try and keep spoilers, and we have done a pretty good job of that. There's so much that we could tell you that we kind of don't want to. But I think the way that it handles its characters, and if nothing else, everything serves to flesh out these characters and make them more interesting. And I think that is what the game's greatest strength is. Like, that is what it does better than anything else, is using these different moments and using these character moments that may or may not technically exist. I mean, they all technically do because of string theory, blah, 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 right? But doing it in a way that makes them, that fleshes them out and makes you go, oh, so this revelation is this and this revelation is that. And then following those lines through, becomes an interesting way of seeing these characters and seeing how they interact in these different timelines and situations.
On top of that, I think we've also forgot to mention a little small thing. This is actually the latest game by Vanillaware, who have made games like Odin Sphere, Grim Grimoire, and also a little game called Dragon's Crown, which means that, hey, this game also has probably the best 2D in video games right now, because holy crap, this game is amazing. It has, like, the best sunsets in any game you've seen in a long time. It's just like, this is gorgeous.
The art is beautiful. Yeah, absolutely.
It's called Hades. Yeah. You should watch our review from it 20 years ago.
Also very quick interject. Much like with Hades, 13 Sentinels is a game I've been thinking about a lot, because it's always constantly on my mind.
Although I've just got a question regarding, like, you two have, like you two have very much been very much focused on the narrative, and it sounds like it's a high wire concept that they managed to land.
Mm.
What about the other half of the game, the real time, the RTS element? Like, does that feel like does that feel strong in the of
a this is where me and Galea differ, because I don't think Galea liked it, and I did, so I'll let him go first.
Okay, I like it enough. Like, I think it's functional. I think it's fine. I just think that it's the aspect of the game that I find the least interesting. But there is some interesting aspects to this mode where it's like, hey, they do some cool things of trying to make you, because at a certain point in the game, you can customize your teams. You can say, okay, I want this character on my team. Great, awesome. But they do some ways to kind of say, okay, you can't constantly have the same team over and over again. You have to kind of rotate them out. So they have mechanics that kind of force you to kind of think of new team comp and all that kind of fun stuff, which that's interesting. And the game, and that part of the game still looks great, but it's also, to me, it's like, I come here for the story, and this is probably, to me, like the worst playing vanilla way game, but that's not a slight. That's not a bad thing to say at all. It's just the least interesting part of this amazing game.
I disagree in that, like, I agree in the sense that people are here for the Vanillaware art and for the Vanillaware story. That's why they're playing this video game. But the way that they do the battles and the way that they do the tower defense, and they hand wave it into the world and make it as part of the universe that it exists in, I think is really well done. Jamie did mention, obviously, they've got systems in place to stop you from using the same characters over and over again. First time you play through it, obviously you don't know a lot of the restrictions and you don't necessarily know the relationship between these characters, but over time they start to become more obvious and also more beneficial. So characters that care about each other, you know, so what one character gets a buff if they attack, and then after they attack, their best friend in the game attacks. So there's all those little buffs and all those little, like, small team ups that are worth paying attention to maximize your output. Keep on, I'm playing it on normal, but I just recently switched it to intense or whatever the next difficulty up is, and you notice a difference straight away. Like, the way that they do it, it looks like a PS1 interface. Like, it's so funny to me. Like, I'm looking at it now, and if this was, like, scaled down, you know, to a quarter of its original thing, I'd assume it was a PS1 game, because it feels like Kessen. It feels like those kind of games on PS1 and PS2 that, you know, the strategy games where, you know, you had this thing. Obviously, they've got a little bit more to do with animations, a little more to do with that, but, you know, you have your different generational robots. They all have different strengths and weaknesses. Gen 1 is melee only. Gen 2 is your mix-ups. Gen 3 is your long range, and Gen 4 is your kind of flying support units. And so setting them up individually to match their pilot, you know, their idiosyncrasies is really, to me, it's rewarding, because it, you know, means you can get quicker completions and stuff like that. And I'm only now starting to get to the point where the enemies are difficult enough for me to go, holy crap, I nearly died there. You know what I mean? Because once you're, the one advantage you have is that once your robot dies, or it's about to die, you can hit recovery mode, and basically they zip out of the robot, and they either run or they're on a motorbike or whatever, and they can escape to, like, a safe point in the map. So let's say you've got someone who's about to die, you can throw another robot in front of them to try and act as cover, you know, distract attention, slash, you know, there's some moves actually pull aggro from the creeps. And so I've had to do that once where I made a real bad call, and I jumped in and I did, like, not a kamikaze, but an AOE missile attack. And it didn't kill everyone. It killed most of them, but it didn't kill everyone. And she just copped it hard. She copped, like, a laser beam, and then she copped all this other. So she got to, like, 1,000 health. And so basically I had to eject her, make her run away, but then luckily one of my melee units, which has, like, an attraction skill, attracted the enemies, so they all just fired on him instead. So she got to run away. The 15-20 seconds it takes to repair the robots passed. So you've got 2 minutes for each battle, two minutes in the sense of that's how long the fight is actually meant to take. But because you're pausing and because you're slowing down time all the time to make your decisions, it doesn't play out linearly like that. So, you know, what was effectively 20 seconds of game time, she recovered, she came back up, and then we finished the map. But, you know, the way that the tension once you lose a robot, once you've only got, like, a scrawny human, one hit from any of the robots and they're dead, it just really, like, it really compounded the idea that, you know, this is a thing. But that said, you know, if you are here for the visual novel element, you can put it on casual and just smash through it. Like, the battles themselves aren't difficult. They're a very simple premise, and sometimes they might have, instead of being protect the Aegis terminal, which is what you're, the terminal you're protecting, it might be kill X amount of these units or kill all of these units or whatever. There might be a specific condition on that map, but 9 times out of 10, you're just defending the tower. And again, you're either going to find that interesting or not. And I had more fun with it than I thought I would. Like, when I first started playing it, I was really worried because I don't like visual novels and I do like tactical RPGs, but it's so overdone now. Everyone does a tactical RPG now. It's the new roguelike. And so I was worried that I wouldn't enjoy it, but I disagree with Jamie in that I really did enjoy it, but at the same time, I wrung my enjoyment out of it. Like, I'm basically doing the visual novel parts to unlock the next bit of the fighting game, of the battle game, and that's not probably the mindset for most people going into this game.
Basically, me, like, I'm the opposite.
Is it would it be fair to call this game a mixture of Fire Emblem and Into the Breach? Because I'm getting kind of, like, the way you're describing it, I'm getting that sort of vibe.
Into the Breach, I would say, is more accurate. Yeah, look, it's tough because it is and it isn't. So it's not grid. There's no grid. There is. The grid is, it consists of, if you are on foot, you have to follow the streets. You can't stomp through buildings. You can blow up buildings accidentally, for sure, and it's one of the metrics your score is measured on, is how much destruction of the city you have. But if you're an on-foot unit, having to run to points, you have to factor in running down streets to do it, which is a cool way to, you know, limit movement without doing it. Flying units, obviously, no such issue. You can just fly to wherever you want. So they're great for getting in, getting out, like the salvos or healing or whatever. But Into the Breach obviously has the random generated elements to it. Fire Emblem has that more straightforward, you know, if someone dies, it's permadeath, and it, you know, you lose that character. If one of the pilots dies in this, it's game over. You cannot lose a pilot for story reasons, because then you literally couldn't do the visual novel. So, like, it does have elements that it shares in common with them, but I wouldn't say that it's a particularly apt comparison on that more beyond the superficial level.
You also wouldn't have the perfect information that you have in something like Enter the Breach, where you know exactly what an enemy's about to do.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so you like, they do have markers to show what their moves are. After a while, you get a feel for it. It's like, right, so it's a high quad, so I need to get my, you know, one hit guy over there to just chop the legs off it. You know, it's a flying map, and I didn't bring any, like, air resistance. I'm in trouble. I might as well just, like, retreat and come back in, because I'm not going to pass it. Like, in the end, one of them, I had the wrong melee class. I put the wrong guy into the attack squad, and he was my... kill my big guy's melee guy, not my anti-air draw aggro run away melee guy, and that was awful. Like, that was, so basically I just put him on defense mode, stood him there, let him take every bullet while everyone else killed him, and he nearly died from it as well. So, you know, it does get to the point where you can specialize your characters to be better, but at the same time, like, it's like Jamie says, it's not quite as straightforward as Into the Breach, where it's like, you know, X is going to happen in two turns kind of thing.
But overall, it seems like you both enjoy the game for, like, indeed the two reasons that the game offers. Does it manage to escape the sort of the barriers of tactical RPG, and the especially higher barrier of visual novel, to be a game that everyone can enjoy?
That's a really, actually, Jason, you want to take this one?
I would say the biggest issue it has is that it's a vanillaware game. So people instantly want Odin Sphere or they want Dragon Crown, and that's what they assumed. They assumed it would be Robot Dragon Crown or Robot Odin Sphere or something like that, which is side-scrolling, which is 2D plane with still that amazing art and all those amazing animations and all that kind of stuff. And this game doesn't have that. This game is way more about those character interactions. And while obviously, you know, especially Odin Sphere, it builds a world and it builds itself out and all that kind of stuff is absolutely true. It's not the same as this, where this is 100% more focused on building your interest in these characters. You know, how these, you know, guys who are fighting off the Americans, like, they assume that the Americans, the Sentinels, the robots in the game, are to fight the Americans. You know what I mean? And then they've got to deal with these people from 2025 and 1985, who live in a very different Japan than they did. And so it's way more about those interesting character moments than it is necessarily about seeing, you know, pretty blonde girls do, you know, 400 hit combos.
I mean, it's a very different game. I feel like it's just... I don't want to say too much, because obviously I think a lot of the game is... Go dive right into it, because that's, I think, the best way to experience it. Like, yeah, it's just, it's a very weird, bizarre game. I think if you're open to something a little different, give it a go. Like, it is, I would say it's a little bit more accessible than something like, say, like, I Love 428 GB Scramble, which is pure visual novel. But at least with that, there is still some, at least with this game, there is still some interactivity. Like, you are moving a character around. You're moving a cursor around to select your stuff on the tactical map, on the tower defense map. There is still a game part to this. But it is still very much a game that's either... It is still a game that's also very heavily story-driven at the same time. Mm. So, in a way, yes, it does kind of feel a little bit more approachable, but also, if you're someone like... But also, Vanillaware has always been a niche thing anyway. So, either you're really into this already, or you are just looking to get into this. So, it's a bit of a weird thing.
I would say you mentioned that obviously myself and Jamie come at it from different points of view. I still find it compelling from the point of view of I enjoy the tactical battles into the visual novel element. I think it's been great fun. I've enjoyed my time with it. It sounds like Jamie's the opposite, where he's more enjoyed the visual novel elements as opposed to the tactical. But I think if anything, that speaks to its ability to capture different markets for different reasons. Like, I've always been a tactical RPG fan. But it being a Vanillaware game doing a really interesting take on a visual novel, I mean, okay, I'm listening, I'm paying attention, you know what I mean? Whereas I think, I don't want to speak for you, Jamie, I'll let you take over, it's more you come into this as someone who enjoys Vanillaware stuff and knows what they're capable of, and we're willing to kind of take the plunge on them doing something different from their usual.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, I mean, you look at every other Vanillaware game, and you could argue all over it. Like, they have a very similar look, very similar feel to them. But this is just wildly different. Like, it's very different what they've done before. And I like Vanillaware, so I am a simp for Vanillaware. So I was going to give it a go no matter what.
Yeah, right.
So you're not too wrong. I'm putting the words in my mouth, but look, I'm just happy that this game exists. I'm happy this game got localized, and I'm happy that there is still the means for people to go give it a shot. So I guess there is one thing I want to end with, because it's a really good... I have another quote here from another legendary game designer, if you will permit me to say that. It's a bit quick, I promise. It's a much shorter quote, I promise. Vanillaware is a treasure we must all protect, so you should definitely buy 13 Sentinels. Even just one more copy sold can make a difference. I usually don't care about whether or not a game will sell or not. I don't even care if Atlas ends up closing down one day. But I definitely don't want Vanillaware to disappear. Japan needs Vanillaware. That was from Yoko Taro.
I was going to guess Kamiya, but Taro would have been my second guess. So there you go. Like, yeah.
And with that, that's all I have to say.
All right. Well,
that's
all Yoko Taro and Samurai has to say. Correct. Yeah. All right. Well, on that note, that is us for the record for today. So thank you everyone for joining us. I'm going to go to a break after this as well. Just so that we can mix it up. I'll see if I'm in the mood for streaming something afterwards. We'll see. But for now, thank you for joining us. Don't forget newgameplus.tv. All of the socials at newgameplus.tv. So Facebook, Twitter, Twitch, YouTube. While you're on Twitch, you should know that one as well. Jamie and Donald, where can people find you on the socials?
They can find me at Jamie M. Galea. That's JamieMGalea. That's on Twitter and Instagram. And yeah, give me a follow. I post a lot of crap, so give me a follow.
It's true, he does. It's true.
Shit posting is a wonderful hobby.
And you can find me on Twitter at @an_bear. That's @an_bear. Or you could find all of us actually on the New Game Plus Discord. The invite is around, or should be floating around somewhere on our socials.
I believe it's below. I think it's also below this Twitch channel if you do want to check it out there.
So join our community. We pop off every now and then, especially in the coming 2.5 hours on the day that we're recording this.
Find
out the next Smash character.
Let's do it quickly then. Dark Horse for Smash, go Donald.
Dark Horse for Smash. I want to say either you need a Microsoft collaboration, I reckon. So the real Dark Horse is Ori from Ori and the Blind Forest.
That's my pick. Yeah.
I don't know. The Just Dance dances.
I would just like to say Banjo-Kazooie is totally a Microsoft pick, so
let the collaboration
continue. I think it was you, Jamie, who said in our Discord that there was Chimchar, I think. No, not Chimchar. What's the new Firestarter?
Cinderace from Sword and Shield, which I don't want, but it's the most logical pick, and that's probably the most boring.
I sadly agree. I think that it will probably be something from Pokemon. As long as it's not Fire Emblem, I think we can all agree, as long as it's not Fire Emblem, I think we'll all be happy.
There is going to be another Fire Emblem character.
If I can have a Dark Horse pick, like something that I would like to see, my go-to is always Chorus Kids. River of Heaven is the best.
These rhythm have 10 Goku kids.
I will say, like, in terms of a Dark Horse that is likely to get in there, I'd put mine in for a character from Ring Fit Adventure, whether it be the Adventurer or Drago or one of the villains in the game. Like, that game, that game became an unexpected success in the pandemic, so it'd be a good way to, and the, what's called the aesthetic fits into Smash Bros. So we already have Wii Fit Trainer, so why not Ring Fit Trainer?
Why not Ring Fit someone? I will second that.
I've heard worse ideas than that. Anyway, gentlemen, that is it for now. Thank you very much for joining me. I'll see if I'm feeling up to it. We'll see. But I'm going to go to the break now. If I'm back after the break, I'm back after the break. If not, I might pop in and just say, sorry, kids, I'm going to go do something else. But thank you very much for joining me, both of you. And don't forget to check us out on the socials listed, and we'll see you later.